Welcome to Green and Red, scrappy politics for scrappy people. A regular podcast on radical, environmental and anti-capitalist politics. Brought to you by Bob Buzzanco and Scott Park.
It's a real question, isn't it? Why? The how and the who is just scenery for the public. Oswald, Ruby, Cuba, the mafia keeps them guessing like some kind of parlor game, prevents them from asking the most important question, why? Why was Kennedy killed? Who benefited? Who has the power to cover it up? Who?
Welcome to the silky smooth sounds of the Green and Red podcast. I'm your co-host, Scott Parkin, in Berkeley, California today. And what you just heard was a clip from Oliver Stone's 1991 blockbuster, JFK, which has been in the news quite a bit lately. And in it, it's the scene where Kevin Costner and Donald Sutherland are talking, and it sort of opens up the conversation about why the military-industrial complex took out Kennedy, which, you know, you're gonna hear a lot about today, which we disagree with. And we're going to actually talk a lot about that sort of why question in the film, and we're going to come at it in a very different way with a very different opinion. And so today we're doing something a little bit different, which is I'm going to be interviewing Bob and talking about a body of work in which he has like worked on for decades. And that is around we're going to talk about the assassination of JFK. We're going to talk about JFK's involvement in the war in Vietnam. And we're going to kind of dig into a lot of what the film talks about, both JFK from 1991, as well as Oliver Stone's new documentary on Showtime, JFK Revisited Through the Looking Glass. So I want to welcome my guest slash co-host, Bob Buzzanco, Dr. Bob Buzzanco, today to talk about JFK. Bob is also the author of Masters of War, Military Dissent and Politics in the Vietnam Era. And so we're going to actually talk a little bit about that. And this is Bob's first book, I believe. Welcome to Green and Red, Bob.
Thank you. I'm a big fan of the podcast. I think it's like the best one out there. It's way better than all those other lefty podcasts. So I'm really thrilled to be here, and especially talking about this, especially in the aftermath of a conversation about this topic with the great Noam Chomsky recently. So very happy to be here.
Right. And, you know, for folks out there, this is a little bit of a follow-up to that conversation. We've been wanting to have this since we found out the film was coming out back in November or whenever it was. And then we were lucky enough to get Professor Chomsky to join us. Bob, maybe we could just like kind of kick off with this a little bit, just to kind of get into it, is that the defenders of Stone, the talking heads that he has in the documentary, they continue to cite a lot of new evidence, and they keep referring to this governmental body that was created, I think, in the mid to late 90s called the Assassination Records Review Board. And they talk a lot about new evidence and new details. And it's like kind of post 91, 92, which is when was Stone's big heyday with the original film. Can you actually talk to us a little bit about that new evidence and what it means or what it doesn't mean?
Yeah, and I will say that's actually the biggest contribution Oliver Stone has made to this entire topic, is that in the 90s, he generated enough interest in it to get this these documents finally looked at, you know, and released. The Assassination Records Review Board is about the assassination itself. It's not about Kennedy's foreign policy or any of Kennedy's policies or anything like that. It's much bigger. I'm not an assassinologist. I'm not one of these Camelot conspiracy cult people, so I haven't looked at it like extensively. The key element to it, I think, is that it provides a lot more and a lot more extensive information now about the intelligence agency's surveillance of and information about Lee Harvey Oswald. And, you know, so it traces Oswald, and, you know, the FBI and the CIA and all these other groups were aware of what he was doing, and they were on to him. And they're implying, or they're more than implying, I think they're saying that was, you know, an element in this government conspiracy that Kennedy killed. No, I don't know if that's because they knew Oswald was going to do it and they let him rather than stop it or what. But the ARB, the Assassination Record Review Board, basically is releasing a great deal of information about something we've already known. There's a report from a House Committee on Assassinations in the late 70s, 78, 79. There's an entire section, which I think I sent to you a couple of weeks ago, which is Oswald's activities pre-assassination. And the intelligence agencies, the CIA, the FBI, everybody was aware of them. Just for fun, the other day, I went on eBay and I found a pamphlet from New Orleans from the Fair Play, because he was very active in the Fair Play for Cuba Committee, which is kind of a pro-Castro group. And he was very public with it. And on eBay for like $3.78, you could get a pamphlet from the New Orleans Fair Play for Cuba Committee with Lee Harvey Oswald's name and address on it, because he was the liaison in New Orleans. The point was, this guy was not in the shadows, you know, the deep state, ooh, and all that kind of stuff. He was in the open. Anybody who was going to be an advocate for Castro in the 60s was going to be on the radar. The intelligence community knew where he was. We know way more about him now. There's nothing in there that I think, as Chomsky said repeatedly, that anybody who looks at this kind of clear-headed, you know, is going to see this going to be a, there's no smoking gun. There's nothing close to a smoking gun. There's no evidence. The evidence remains overwhelmingly against these Stone and others conspiracy, these Camelot conspiracies. So the new records are there. They're great. They trace Oswald in detail, but they're not about the kind of guts of this, the key question, right? Which is, you know, why would they want Kennedy dead? It's not about his policies. It's not about Vietnam. It's not about foreign policy. It's not about the military. It's not about, it's about, you know, kind of the surveillance and the assassination itself. And, you know, look, I mean, it's possible that there were other people involved. I mean, clearly we know the Miami Cubans hated Kennedy, right? And we know the mob didn't like him. But, you know, after 58 years, whatever, and a gazillion investigations, and how many people would have been involved in that? I mean, you got a conspiracy with like thousands of people and they're all been quiet about it and no one's found any evidence. So it's unfortunate that people, especially on the left, are taking this seriously. We've seen articles recently in Jacobin, Counterpunch has had a couple, a Majority Report had a particularly unctuous one with this young guy calling everybody who, you know, didn't think that Stone was right. He called them babies. That's the kind of guy you want in the streets with you, isn't it? You know, when the shit goes down, I want him there with me. I mean, it's embarrassing. And I think it's dangerous for people on the left to kind of go looking for these saviors, these heroes, these conspiracies. It's not as pernicious as what we're seeing right now with Trump and the lies about the election and QAnon. You know, it's not quite as dangerous, obviously, but it's not good. It doesn't do us well to kind of go about, you know, and look for these kind of deep state dark secrets in lieu of just essentially analyzing the world as it exists, what we know. You know, the great I.F. Stone, a brilliant journalist, once said that, you know, all he had to do was look at government reports. Gabriel Kolko, brilliant historian, you know, I was talking to him once about this, my book, actually, Master War, when I was doing it. He said, you could write a great history of the Vietnam War just using nothing but the New York Times. You know, and clearly there are forces that we don't know about that operate in the shadows, right? We know that, the CIA, the FBI. But we also kind of know what they do, right? I mean, you know, you don't know where they are right now, but you know that people in your community are targeted by them, right? You know that they're after the environmental movement. They have been for forever. You know they're after animal rights advocates. You know they're after anti-war advocates. You know they're after Black Lives Matter and Antifa. We know that, right? So this isn't like some deep, dark, you know, unknown force with a bunch of guys, you know, like in a smoke-filled room, right? What was that guy's name? Birch Barlow on The Simpsons, right? It's not like that. Like, they're bad people and they do bad things. And we don't know about it all, but, you know, it's not some shadow state that's assassinating Kennedy, who's one of them, you know?
Well, It's interesting to David Talbot, who is one of the talking heads, who's an independent journalist, researcher, independent historian.
Founder of Salon, wasn't he?
Was he?
I think he was the founder of Salon, yeah.
He's one of the talking heads in JFK Revisited. And if you look at his Wikipedia page and how he describes himself, that he's very focused on work around the hidden history of the power of U.S. power. And, you know, it's not hidden. It plays out on the front page of the New York Times and the business page and the Financial Times all the time. They don't have, it's hidden in plain sight, if anything.
Yeah. I mean, I you know, I don't want to sound too boastful, but I know a little bit about this. I've been studying it for a long time, you know, more most of my life. And, you know, I mean, there's not much there that you don't know. I mean, it's a question of getting it out. I mean, but I don't read these things and say, occasionally I do. Somebody will do something new. I was like, oh, I didn't know that, right? But I mean, you know, just, I mean, to throw something totally unrelated out there, you know, like the U.S. assistance to Suharto and the murder of maybe a million Indonesians, right? You know, in the last 10 years, that's become a big issue. I read about that 25 years ago. So yeah, it's hidden in plain sight. We know the way power operates. We don't know all the details. I think that's really ironic because nobody does more than the Green and Red podcast to talk about the way power operates. I mean, you know, in 2020 and 21, when everybody was going nut, hysterical, panicky, we're the ones telling people, you know, Wall Street and the military are going to stop Trump in his tracks. We didn't do that because we had secret information. We weren't talking to Jamie Dimon and Mark Milley. It was there. You know, you just had to look at it.
And also in contrast to what the Stone assassination cult says is that, you know, that has all come out. Lots of it, I don't know if all of it's come out, but lots of it has come out. Like we know what Milley called the head of the Chinese army, right?
Yeah.
But it's all come out. It's not like some hidden conspiracy against Trump.
No, I mean, you don't keep a conspiracy involving thousands of people under wraps for 58 years. It's just not possible. And it's just, I you know, I like talking about this and I know a fair amount about it. I think, you know, I wrote my stuff after Chomsky's Rethinking Camelot and it had a great influence on me. And we communicated quite a bit during that. And, you know, it's just there. And you know, I'm on the same side as people who I disagree with vehemently about a lot of things. You know, there are a lot of people who, you know, like Max Boot in the Washington Post thinks that the conspiracy people are crazy. Well, so do I, but I think Max Boot is horrendous, right? So yeah, I'm on the same side as a lot of people. I'd rather not be, but the fact is, it's just, that's the way it goes. You know, you have to look at the evidence and figure out what it means. And this is overwhelming. We'll talk about some of it in detail. But I just politically, as somebody on the left, I don't think it serves us well at all to kind of say, we had this great hero when he was struck down. You know, last thing I'll say on this, a few years ago, I had this friend, not so much anymore because, you know, you can only take so much in 20 and 21 with COVID and Trump. But he sent me this video several years ago. And I looked at about it's like 15 minutes long. And the first 10 minutes were all about like the power of Wall Street and the power of corporations and, you know, all this stuff. And it's like, okay, it makes sense. And then it goes into like, and there were heroic figures who were going to stop them. And it was JFK and Trump. And it turns out it was one of the early QAnon videos. I didn't find that out until the end, right? And it's the same thing. They're looking for these heroes, these, you know, these saviors, right? You know, waste your summer praying in vain for a savior to rise for these streets, right? And that's what they're doing. And that's not politics. Politics is like, you know, we're talking on Martin Luther King weekend and we both look at King in you know, the most positive ways. I mean, I don't have idols, but King is an immensely important and inspirational figure, right? But, you know, King's work was based on the organizing and the activism, the resistance of a lot of millions of other people. You know, and he would be the first person to say that. So looking for these saviors, Kennedy was single-handedly taking on, you know, there was recently an interview with Stone and it was in USA Today, it was on video. And he said, Kennedy was a rebel against the establishment, right? A rebel against the establishment and a warrior for peace. But what really got me was he said that Kennedy realized that the military and intelligence communities were getting bigger and bigger budgets and gaining more power. And therefore it was in their interest to have kind of conflict in the world, right? Because that gave them more power and more money, right? And that interest in money and power and global conflict, as Stone put it, quote, is what Kennedy understood. And this is what he paid for with his life. John Kennedy broke through. Nobody knew that before 1962 or whatever, right? That the military industrial, Eisenhower pointed that out, right? And his fellow judge. In 1953, Eisenhower made a moving speech, the Cross of Iron speech, advocating, you know, a peaceful world. This is after Stalin died. I mean, Eisenhower's record is far more dovish or pacific than Kennedy's was, right? And according to Stone, Kennedy realized that, you know, the light bulb went off. He understood that the power of the military industrial complex was immense and they were having all this money and they were, you know, gaining from global conflict. And so they had him eliminated. it's just so utterly preposterous. So,
you know, it's a really good segue. The sort of Stone, John Newman, David Talbot, sort of
Fletcher Prouty,
assassinology sort of cult. You know, they spend a lot of time going through details about magic bullets and where Lee Harvey Oswald was in the summer of 1963 and all of this sort of thing. And then they sort of make this leap because their thesis is that the military-industrial complex disagreed with what you were just talking about with, you know, more troops in Vietnam, the escalation of the Cold War. And there's like some level of interest with, you know, that you can find in the sort of like comings and goings of shady figures like Lee Harvey Oswald or whatever. But then all of a sudden they just take this complete leap that it was like, you know, it was this plan was hatched at the highest levels. And because they disagree with Kennedy's dovish policies on Vietnam. And so maybe we could actually just start with that a little bit. Can you get into a little bit of the background into JFK's policies and then the actual realities of what was going on in Vietnam in the early 60s?
Well, you know, remember in November of 2020, right? We did a show on the myths of JFK. And, you know, we pointed out he was a friend of Joe McCarthy and a huge supporter. I mean, he didn't show up on the day of the censure vote against McCarthy. He was an advocate of increased defense budgets. In grad school, I had a professor many years ago who was a very kind of moderate, you know, guy, wasn't, you know, no radical, no flamethrower. And he said, you know, when he thinks of the Cold War, he thought of three people in particular, Dean Acheson, John Foster Dulles, and John F. Kennedy. Those were like the three prototypical Cold Warriors. And when Kennedy ran for president in 1960, he ran to the right of Richard Nixon. He attacked Nixon and Eisenhower because they were soft on Cuba. They let Castro come to power. And especially striking was Kennedy kept invoking the missile gap, you know, attacking Eisenhower and Nixon. There's a missile gap. He was right. There was a massive, immense missile gap. The US had 20,000 nukes and the Soviet Union had 1,600, right? And so Kennedy ran this campaign vowing to make America stronger, right? So this is who he was. And with regard to Vietnam, he was one of the midwives, as it were, of the Ngo Dinh Diem presidency. Diem, you know, was kind of on the run. He was, I called him the Cato Kaelin of Southeast Asia. I don't think anybody knows that reference anymore. He was just bopping around, flopping on people's couches. And he was in the United States for a while. He was a Catholic. Francis Cardinal Spellman, Mike Mansfield, and John Kennedy became friends with him. And so that's one of the reasons he became president in 1954. And Kennedy said, you know, Vietnam is the key. What did he call it? The something in the arch and the finger in the dike. And Vietnam is the place where we have to stop communism in Asia, right? So Kennedy, you know, ran to the right. His whole life was based on being a Cold War. He would not have become president in 1960 otherwise, right? And then, you know, within a few months of taking office, he has two major crises, the Bay of Pigs, which goes badly. And again, I've studied this, like the military was not gung-ho about this. There were elements in the CIA, and Alan Dulles was an advocate of it, which is basically, I think, Talbot's argument. But the military wasn't gung-ho about the Bay of Pigs, and that went badly. And then the Berlin Wall was constructed, and that kind of forces Kennedy's hand, right? Kennedy didn't see those and say, oh, you know, what am I? Kennedy saw those and said, I have to become more warlike. I have to become more bellicose, right? And Walt Rostow, one of his advisors, said, you know, one way to get out of this, you know, public relations disaster, basically, of the Bay of Pigs at Berlin was what he called clean-cut success in Vietnam. And, you know, so Kennedy saw that. He also saw, you know, in that region, he had also been warned by Eisenhower that the problems in Laos were going to come back, you know, weren't going away because Laos was undergoing a kind of a communist revolution as well, much like Vietnam was. So Kennedy basically made a very conscious decision about Vietnam based on everything that he believed in his entire life. That's who he was. And so, you know, in a few short years, what you have is an increase in the ARV, the Southern Army, the Army of the Republic of Vietnam, by 20,000 troops. So 170,000 troops. Those are paid for by the U.S. The U.S. is pouring billions of dollars of support into southern Vietnam. The Civil Guard, which kind of maintains internal security, from 32,000 to 68,000 troops, so the U.S. paid to more than double it. ZM received about $300 million in 1961 alone. And then one of my favorite stories is in May of 1961, Vietnam, things weren't going well. You know, the National Liberation Front, the Viet Cong, had far more initiative, far more popularity. So in May of 1961, Kennedy sent his vice president, Lyndon Johnson, to Saigon. And, you know, Johnson's like 6'4" and ZM is very, very short. And he has his arm around him. He calls him the Winston Churchill of Southeast Asia. And later on the way back, Stanley Karnow, famous journalist, said, you know, where did that come from? And Johnson laughed and he said, shit, man, he's the only boy we got down here. And that basically was what U.S. was doing in Vietnam. They had to find some way to try to take on Ho Chi Minh. And they knew that, you know, ZM was the best they could do and they were in trouble. And Kennedy ratcheted things up the entire time. He, in 1962, he sent out, he committed helicopter companies, Army helicopter companies, fixed wing aircraft, troop carriers, recon planes, air controllers, crop defoliants, Navy minesweepers, CS gas, Agent Orange, and napalm. That was Kennedy in 1962, right? When Kennedy took over in 1961, when he became president in 1961, there were 800 advisors, so-called advisors, in Vietnam. By late 1962, there were 11,000. And then by the time he was assassinated, 16,700, with plans to withdraw 1,000. We'll get to that in a minute, because that's not what Oliver Stone says it was, right? The basic idea in 1962 was that all of this firepower, this introduction of firepower and troops, was really making a difference, and the U.S. had turned the tide and was doing quite well. And Kennedy was very pleased with that, because that was his idea. We have to win. And that continued into 1963 when things turned bad, they went sour. And then at the point where Oliver Stone is saying Kennedy, you know, decided Vietnam was a disaster and he had to get out, in fact, he's doing even more. He's taking it even further in the other direction.
And so, you know, in early November 1963, there's a coup against ZM, which leads to ZM and his brother, who's the head of the secret police, being killed in the coup, which is one of the things that Stone cites as a reason that, like, JFK, you know, starts getting cold feet on Vietnam. But can you actually tell us what the coup against ZM shows us about JFK's commitment to the war?
Yeah. I think it's ironic that Stone would say that too, because ZM was killed on November 1st. Kennedy was killed on November 22nd. So in 3 weeks, apparently, Kennedy has had this road to Damascus, this massive epiphany, and he's going to renounce everything. I mean, it's so insane. It's ridiculous. The coup is huge, right? The United States had had a very mixed relationship, to put it euphemistically, with ZM and his brother. No Din ZM, No Din Nu. And the No NGO family was very well known in Vietnam. One of the uncles, I believe, was an emissary to the Vatican, and one of them was the bishop in Hue. And it's this really old and well-known Catholic family in Vietnam, very well connected all over the place, right? And his brother was kind of like the chief of staff, chief of state. I always kind of envision him as kind of a Dick Cheney kind of character, right? Kind of pulling levers and strings and stuff like that. And the U.S. thought Nu rather than ZM was the real problem there. And, you know, they were on the same team, you know? So, and it was very clear that things were bad. Things were bad in the war. The National Liberation Front, the Viet Cong, were, you know, had the initiative, which everybody in the U.S., every agency in the U.S. understood. And they were getting worse into 1963. And at the same time, two things occurred. One, very well known, the Neo family, ZM and Nu, basically had a public war in the streets against the Buddhists. And we're very familiar with that, especially the very famous photo of the Bonds Quang Duc, who went to a street in Saigon and poured gasoline on himself and immolated himself, right? We talked to Jack Downey about that like a couple of years ago. It's also the cover of the first Rage Against the Machine album, right? And so that was well known. And, you know, the troops, you know, ZM sent the troops into the pagodas. So there's this very public attack going on. And so you have political warfare between the majority, big majority Buddhists and ZM, and that alienates the US. And so beginning in mid 1963, American officials like Henry Cabot Lodge, who was the ambassador, Maxwell Taylor, who had been the ambassador, was now the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, and others, McNamara, the Secretary of Defense, Robert McNamara, Secretary of State Dean Rusk, Secretary of State for Near East Affairs, Roger Hilsman, Assistant Secretary of Defense, Roswell Gilpatrick, and a bunch of other people, Walt Rostow, you know, Bundy, George Bundy, others, began to seriously say, okay, what are we gonna do? This has reached a crisis. And the key element in all this is every single one of them, including John Kennedy, is saying the war is, we've lost, we're screwed. We cannot continue along this path, right? And so if Kennedy wanted to get out of the war, boom, there's his excuse. He has many excuses, and I'll talk about another one later. One of them is like, we can't, you know, continue to be supportive of a government that attacks its own people, that invades pagodas, that incites people to immolate themselves and things like that. It's just not, you know, that's not what we stand for, some kind of bullshit like that. So we could have done that. No, what did he do? He doubled down and said, no, ultimately the decision was we have to change things there. Now, at first they said, let's get rid of New, make him get rid of, no, they knew his brother. And they already knew that was never going to happen, right? But they decided, you know, that they were going to, you know, make that approach first. Now, there's a lot of detail in this, and I don't want to just go into a long dredge of reading a bunch of documents and things like that. So you're going to have to either, like, read about it or take my word for it. There is a significant dialogue occurring on a daily basis at the White House, at the Department of State, at the Pentagon, regarding what to do about ZM. And this is taking place from in real intense fashion from August onwards. So you have August and September and October, 3 months at least of deep, deep, deep discussions and finally planning to get rid of Nodin ZM. I mean, if you are somehow committed to getting out of that war, why would you go in deeper? Because once you have a coup and you overthrow a government, you now own it. Right? You break it, you bought it. That's yours now. And it was before. It already was. It was Kennedy's government already, as much as anybody's. I mean, I would say that the Ngo family and the Republic of Vietnam belonged to John Kennedy as much as anybody, more than Eisenhower, really. Right. So the coup becomes really critical. Kennedy was told, we can't tolerate a situation in which power lies in New's hands, the brother, right? So they're gonna have to do something about it. And in fact, Kennedy told people in both Washington and Saigon to notify people in the Southern military. Now, if there's going to be a coup, it's going to have to be the Southern military. The U.S. is already in constant contact with people in the Southern military and in the Southern intelligence apparatus, so in the diplomatic corps. So all of these connections are already made. The United States and the anti-ZM opposition in the South are already talking to each other, right? And the U.S. notified diplomatic and consular and military officials to tell their South Vietnamese counterparts that, and this is an important quote, we will give them direct support in any interim period of breakdown of the central government mechanism. So they were told ahead of time, if the coup occurs and there's turmoil, the United States is going to be there for you, right? Now, would you do that if you were getting ready to get out of that war? Of course not, right? That's preposterous, right? And there's so much like that, you know. Rusk says we're on the road to disaster if ZM stays in power. And the basic idea there is that if nothing happens, if ZM stays in power, you're either going to, choices are either a complete deterioration of the situation or the introduction of US forces. Now, Stone makes a big deal out of that. You know, this idea that Kennedy didn't want to send more troops in. Nobody wanted to send more troops in. As late as November 21st, 1963, nobody, including the military, thought that there would be a big US war in Vietnam. That was not feasible. There was no reason to assume that. You had 16,700 troops in Vietnam. You had introduced firepower. You were sending significant amounts of aid. Nobody assumed that there would be a big war in Vietnam. Nobody assumed there'd be a big war in Brazil. Nobody assumed there'd be a big war in Guyana. Nobody assumed there'd be a big war in Bolivia. Nobody assumed there'd be a big war in Indonesia. There was no reason to. You just fought World War II against the Germans. You're fighting the Cold War against the Soviet Union. no one is anticipating a major war against the Republic in Vietnam. So the idea that Kennedy wasn't planning, that's probably, he never was. He didn't have to draw down because nobody in Washington, D.C., including the deep state, was assuming there would be some kind of major conflict in Vietnam. What the U.S. wanted to do was to make sure it didn't get drawn in deeper. And the fact was every planning paper, every contingency included the idea that we can't do that. You know, we can't take over that war. We don't want to. And they didn't make that decision until well after Kennedy was dead. Johnson didn't want to either. That's the thing. There's a great continuity. We can talk about that later, too. There's a lot of continuity between Kennedy and Johnson. So if Kennedy was, you know, in on it, Johnson was, too, because they did basically the same thing. Anyway, but the coup, by late August, American planning is well underway. If ZM, Kennedy himself said, if ZM won't go along with us and get rid of his brother and make these reforms, demand some reforms, Kennedy himself said, we can't withdraw this demand. Once we told him, we're in, so we're all in. And they were. And so, you know, it continued. There are two other things. I don't want to kid, you know, I talk about this and I do talk about this a lot, but there are two other things that I think are important. And because Stone talks about them, and these are in Stone's movie. Kennedy had two interviews in September. One with Chet Huntley, one with Walter Cronkite. And Stone cropped them very carefully to imply that Kennedy said, we've got to get out of the war. But if you look at those entire interviews or read a transcript of them, both in the September 2nd interview with Cronkite and the one he did with Huntley, I think a week or two later, what he says is all we can do is help. It is a very important struggle, even though it is far away. American withdrawal only makes it easier for the communists. I think we should stay. All right. Now that's Kennedy in September, right? Something else occurs in September that's very important. Kennedy sends two of his ranking officials, the Secretary of Defense, McNamara, and the Chair of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, Maxwell Taylor, to Vietnam. This is the famous McNamara-Taylor mission. And they came back and filed a report, the McNamara-Taylor report. The McNamara-Taylor report became, boom, I'll throw it to you.
NSA memo 263.
Boom, there you go.
Oliver Stone and John Newman, who's the author of JFK in Vietnam, the book was heavily used for Oliver Stone's JFK script. As proof that JFK was committed to withdrawing from Vietnam without victory. Key two words there, without victory. But how is this not the case?
Well, I'm going to have to go get my fire extinguisher because NSAM 263 is a smoking gun, right? NSAM 263 appeared on Kennedy's desk in October, I think October 11th of 1963. It was essentially the McNamara-Taylor report. McNamara and Taylor went to Vietnam and they saw some signs of improvement. It was a very imprecise report. It was riddled with contradictions. George McKeon, who is brilliant. If you're going to start reading about Vietnam, I would say Kahn and Colco. There's a few people you want to start with, and those two, Marilyn Young. But George McKeon, when he analyzed 263, said, you know, they covered their butts, basically. They said a lot of stuff, right? So, they reaffirmed the commitment to Vietnam in 263. This episode has really been misrepresented to make a claim opposite. McNamara and Taylor came back and said, oh, we have great progress in Vietnam. So, you know, you have all this progress, right? So why would you get out, right? And this is important. They said things are going well. So maybe we can withdraw 1,000 troops by the end of 1963, and then maybe we could phase out the bulk of American troops by the end of 1965, right? So which is 24 months in the future. At the end of that, the White House issued a statement on its commitment to Vietnam. On October 11th, Kennedy authorized NSAM 263 with the plan to withdraw 1,000 troops out of the 16,700. So we're talking about, 7% of the troops or something like that. Anyway, we're not talking about like a massive, you know, de-escalation or, you know, it's nothing like Afghanistan earlier, you know, or last year with Biden. It's nothing at all like that. And what was important, and this is really crucial because this too is American policy from the beginning. NSAM 263 said that the key to any kind of withdrawal would be to train the Vietnamese, the Southern Vietnamese, right, to take over the essential functions of the war by 1965. That was always the point. The United States is there to train the Vietnamese and to provide them with the resources they need to fight the war, right?
They're real clear in the memo that the overriding objective of whatever it is they're doing, it's Vietnamization, like what Nixon did, you know, five, six, 7 years later. But they're real clear that the overriding objective is victory, right? It's not leave without victory.
No. And the idea of Americanization doesn't take root until the summer of 1965, because things are even worse. And that was the major, you know, the LBJ escalation. But nobody in the United States, the most hawkish Americans, were not saying, oh, we have to take over the war. The idea had always been, I mean, you know, think of the fact Nixon had to Vietnamize the Vietnam War. I mean, that's Orwellian, right? We're going to Vietnamize their war. But the idea was always, it's their war. And so NSAM 263, and then a month later, a few days after Kennedy died, Johnson signed off on NSAM 273, which essentially said the same thing. And both of those, the first line says, America's central objective in Vietnam was to take the actions necessary to prevent communist victory in the South. Yeah, so you have that, right? So the coup plotting continues, and the coup takes place on November 1st. Now, nobody anticipated ZM and New being murdered. And that apparently, by all accounts, shook Kennedy. He was ashen when he heard about that and saw photos. They were killed and their bodies were in a van. They were supposed to be given passage to Paris, right? And I have no doubt that that shook him up. But I mean, Kennedy was no choir boy. I mean, he had seen, I mean, how many times had he tried to assassinate Castro? I mean, the guy is aware that, hey, you know, Roger Hilsman, had a famous line. He said, revolutions are bloody, people get hurt, you know, and Kennedy's aware of that. So yeah, he was shaken by it, but I don't see anything that would indicate that there was like some kind of, there is nothing to indicate there was any kind of change of heart. So so Kennedy is aghast, but there, on that meeting, while the coup was taking place on November 1st, Kennedy, one of his main concerns wasn't what was going on in Vietnam. He said, we're going to have to go to the media, because there had recently been a coup in Honduras, which the United States had opposed. And he said, we're gonna have to figure out how to go to the media and, you know, support this coup after we just opposed a coup in Honduras. That was Kennedy's, it was a public relations issue to him, right? Mm-hmm. And then just the final piece on all this, and Chomsky talks about this a lot. If you've ever read his speech that he was going to give in Dallas at the Trademark on November 22nd, that alone should dissuade you. The last speech he gave in Fort Worth, just a few hours before he was assassinated, Kennedy said, without the United States, South Vietnam would collapse overnight. Does that sound like somebody who's ready to get out, right? And then the speech at the Trademark, though, was incredible. It's long, it's available online. He starts, and this administration has been necessary at times to issue specific warnings. Warnings that we could not stand by and watch the communists conquer Laos by force or intervene in the Congo or swallow West Berlin or maintain offensive missiles on Cuba. But while our goals were at least temporarily obtained in these and other instances, our successful defense of freedom was due not to the words we used, but to the strength we stood ready to use on behalf of the principles we stand ready to defend. Boom, right? It's weapons, not it's swords, not plowshares.
How that doesn't make it into any of those.
No. And this speech he was going to do. And then he bragged that they'd increase the number of Polaris subs by 50%, Minuteman missiles by 75%, raise the number of strategic bombers on 15-minute alert by 50%, increase the number of nuclear weapons available by 100%, raise the level of tactical nuclear forces in Western Europe by 60%, raise the number of combat-ready army divisions by 45%, and so on and so on. And finally says, our assistance to these nations can be painful, risky, and costly, as is true in Southeast Asia today, but we dare not weary of the task. Boom. That's Kennedy in November of 1963. The moment at which Oliver Stone thinks he's beating all these swords into plowshares, he's in fact being Kennedy. He's being who he always was. He's ramping things up. He's not making any plans to even de-escalate, let alone to get out. The idea for withdrawal was based on the reports he'd heard that the war was going well. And they heard these at the same time. They're planning to depose the government, which they did. you know, you don't do all this if you're trying to get out of a situation, right? You know, you try to make it, you know, easier. And Kennedy did nothing like that, you know? So it's just, and they don't talk about this because it doesn't suit them. They'd rather talk about the Assassination Record Review Board and, you know, where was Oswald on November 12th and what did Oswald do and who was following him and all this and that. But the reality is, you know, the people who they claim killed Kennedy had no reason to have any issues with Kennedy. He was one of them. He was in that room smoking cigars with them, right? He was drinking scotch with them. He had some personal issues with people like Alan Dulles. Absolutely. You know, not everybody in the ruling class likes one another. You think everybody liked Nixon, you know? I mean, dude, you want a conspiracy theory? Nixon went to freaking China and cut a deal with both Moscow and Beijing, right? And Kennedy did nothing like that. So it's insane. It's utterly ridiculous.
So one last question I want to ask you in the sort of in Stone's conspiracy realm, which is around the military. And so Stone in both the Hollywood JFK film and in the documentary, which is a Hollywood film too, JFK Revisited, he portrays the military as wanting to go into Vietnam aggressively, and JFK was the obstacle, right? He's the dove in the room. And you know, based on your work with Masters of War, Military Dissent and Politics in the Vietnam Era, how was this actually, in fact, the opposite?
Yeah, I gotta say, I am bragging here. This is my wheelhouse. I've been studying this and I know it pretty well as probably, you know, pretty much anybody who studied it, right? And I mean, I can't talk about it in depth because I'll go on for hours and hours and hours. So you can go out and buy the book, which, you know, Green and Red Podcast will be glad to autograph for you, right? There's so much here to unravel. The idea, and I've heard not just Stone, but many of the people who supported him say, you know, like the military wanted to go in Vietnam, or the military killed him because they thought he was going to get out of Vietnam. That just makes me incensed. It's just like I scream, I rage into the void, you know, when I hear that. That's there's absolutely nothing for that. The United States military from 1945 on, when the OSS was working with Hudson Min to rescue downed flyers behind Chinese line, right? Never was eager to fight in Vietnam. It was generally pessimistic. At best, it had reservations. It never contemplated any kind of introduction of combat troops into Vietnam. It never contemplated any kind of big war in Vietnam. I mean, just from the start, throughout the 1950s, there was brief discussion at the NBN Phu of the United States supporting the French. If anybody more than anyone else, it was the US military, especially Army Chief of Staff Matthew Ridgway, who put a stop to that. J. Lawton Collins, who was also an Army Chief of Staff and later the first ambassador to the Republic of Vietnam. These guys were adamant about staying out of any kind of conflict. You know, the famous line from MacArthur and the Princess Bride, never fight a land war in Asia, right? No group, really, I mean this, like no group was as adamant about staying out of the war in Vietnam as the US military was. There are like one of my doctoral advisors, you know, when I handed my dissertation, made a joke about, Jesus Christ, you have 20,000 whiny quotes from military people who don't want to fight in Vietnam. And there's like 20,000 quotes about military people saying, we don't want to fight in Vietnam. I mean, you know, I could sit here and go on a long dialogue, or a monologue, I guess, about it, right? You know, just to kind of, I'm looking at some stuff here and just kind of randomly picking things out. The commander of the U.S. Pacific Fleet, Harry Felt, strongly opposed to troop deployments. In large measure, and this is important too, because it goes back to what we said before about training the Vietnamese. The idea in the military was if the United States starts sending troops into Vietnam, the Vietnamese are going to do even less because they're going to let the U.S. take over the war, which is kind of what happened, right, with the Americanization, right? John Paul Vann, made famous, especially by Neil Sheehan's Bright Shining Lie, was very important. He was the guy who was the main source for Sheehan and Halberstam in the New York Times stories about how bad the war was going. David Shoup, who was the commandant of the Marine Corps, one of my personal icons. Shoup was, I forget where, he was under the command of Smedley Butler in the 20s and 30s, and he was inspired by him. Shoup was really outspoken about Vietnam as commandant of the Marine Corps. And then to kind of continue the tree, I think Anthony Zinni, didn't he often invoke Shoup as one of his personal kind of mentors and heroes?
Yeah, and for folks, he was a Marine general who opposed the war in Iraq.
Yeah.
In the early 2000s.
Right, which is kind of a thing. You know, military guys, they're not doves. They love budgets. They love weapons. They love, you know, shiny new things and airplanes and carriers and tanks and all that kind of stuff. They're not as gigged about fighting. You know, they want like, one of my lines in my book is, you know, they'd rather fight political wars on the Potomac than real wars on the Mekong, you know, and they had no real fire to go, you know, fight in Vietnam. But Shoup was really hardcore against it. Wallace Greene replaced Shoup as commandant. And in 1963, he said, "We're up to our knees in a quagmire in Vietnam." This is 1963. "Frankly, we do not want to get any more involved in Vietnam." This is the commandant of the Marine Corps, the guys who were at the DMZ, right? These guys were in charge of I Corps. These are the guys who fought those brutal battles and took huge losses, right? They didn't want to be there, right? Greene said, this is Wallace Greene, the commandant of the Marine Corps. He's talking to fellow Marine officers, right? He says, "You see what happened to the French? Well, maybe the same thing's going to happen to us," right? It's the commandant of the Marine Corps, right? But the Kennedy administration sent more and more support. They just ignored that. And there is just this immense amount. Greene, right before, you know, in late 1963, said, you know, "We're not doing much with what we have in Vietnam." You know, Victor Krulak, who was the head of the Pacific Marine Fleet, and Donald Bennett, who was, and Bennett's interesting, he's the director of strategic planning for the Army, also expressed their reservations about the war. And Bennett later said, and this is really striking, I think, because this is the timeline we're talking about. Donald Bennett, who was the director of strategic planning for the Army, General Bennett, said, "Certainly from September of 1963 on, the forcing into war in Vietnam, as far as I could tell, came from the civilian side." And that continued after Kennedy was killed, right? William Westmoreland, this is the thing, right? If these guys wanted Kennedy dead because he wasn't going to go in Vietnam, wouldn't you anticipate a change in policy? But you don't. LBJ continues. NISAM 273 is basically the same as NISAM 263. The military, who allegedly wanted Kennedy dead because he wouldn't fight, continued to say, "Don't go into Vietnam," right? Nobody was more adamant, including Westmoreland. Westmoreland is like the architect of the war. You know, veterans used to deride him and say, waste more men, right? To insult him, right? Westmoreland in 1964 said, "I do not contemplate putting troops into Vietnam. It would be a mistake." He told Maxwell Taylor, the chair of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, his boss, he said, "It's the Vietnamese war, it's their war." And that was always the US line, it's their war, right? But the one that really got me, in January of 1965, this is not long before they actually introduced combat troops, LBJ, and they did that. Bundy and Rusk and everybody just said, "The war's going so badly. I mean, we're at zero hour, right? It's about to end where things are so bad." But Westmoreland in 1965 was asked, you know, to what his opinion was on, you know, what the US should do. And he said, "Well, the advisory effort basically hasn't worked," right? He said, "If that effort hasn't succeeded, there's even less reason to think that US combat forces would have the desired effect. I mean, if our advisors haven't worked, then, you know, why would you assume that combat troops would?" And then what to me was really amazing is Westmoreland said, "If we send troops in, it would, quote, at best buy time and would lead to ever increasing commitments until, like the French, we would be occupying an essentially hostile foreign country." January 1965 was at 14 months after Kennedy was killed. Stone alleges that the military killed him because they didn't want to go into Vietnam. And in January of 1965, they're still saying we shouldn't go into Vietnam. And they're hardened, their positions have hardened, their reluctance is hardened. It just utterly destroys this insane conspiracy theory that Stone and others have had. And if you look beyond Vietnam, it doesn't, there's even more evidence beyond that. But I mean, clearly, the coup and the military's opposition to this, I mean, if you're looking for smoking guns, that's it. If these people who allegedly killed Kennedy because he wasn't fighting hard enough, didn't want to fight themselves, and once he was dead, didn't change policies, then what do you have? What do you have? You have this hand of sand, right? You have this rope of sand, right? It's preposterous. And for people to just, you know, and I've noticed, because we've gotten a few social media scraps, and the defenders basically just, their arguments are kind of like, you know, so's your old man. They're like, well, you're just a this or you're just a that. There's no evidence. There's no, the Assassination Review Board has nothing to do with the Vietnam War. Zero. Has nothing to do with Kennedy's assistance to overthrow Castro or assassinate foreign leaders or anything like that.
Yeah, I mean, it's really interesting the feedback we've gotten. We've gotten a lot of, just so folks know, we've gotten a lot of supportive feedback about with our Chomsky interview, but we've also gotten a lot of like negative feedback about how Chomsky and Buzzanco are like, they haven't seen the new evidence and they refuse to see it. And there's all kinds of new proof that you're just refusing to look at. But in reality, they're, you know, so the CIA was following Lee Harvey Oswald around, whatever. But, you know, there's no new evidence at all. And they definitely aren't citing any documents other than NSA memo 263 and whatever else that, you know, that JFK was like fully devoted to, you know, when and at whatever it took, at whatever cost it took in Vietnam.
And to be clear, I have looked at the new records. I mean, I haven't read word for word, but I've looked at them. And, you know, as I'm looking, I was like, okay, yeah, that's, I mean, it's details to something that we've already known, which is, it's useful. It's great. I'm not deriding it. Does it change the story? No, not at all. Absolutely not. Right.
You know, and just to kind of shift to another topic, which Stone and his research team, I believe is what he calls them. He actually was on the Joe Rogan show for 3 or 4 hours recently talking about all of this. And
I need a research team. Do we have money in the budget for a research team?
You got me.
But come on, people, send money, donate to the Green Red Podcast so we can have a research team.
GreenRedPodcast.org, hit that support button. To kind of go back to another point that Stone makes is that JFK was not only interested in, like, you know, not escalating in Vietnam, pulling out of Vietnam, but he also is interested in, you know, ending the Cold War, breaking the CIA up into 1,000 pieces, and to look at the Cold War policies that were going outside of Vietnam in the Kennedy era, that is also not the case. And, you know, Latin America is a very good case study. There's actually a line in JFK Revisited where Stone is talking about how JFK wanted to normalize relations with Castro in Cuba, which I find preposterous. And I'm wondering if you could actually talk a little bit about some of the Kennedy policies towards Latin America and the Caribbean, et cetera.
I mean, I mean, if you're going to normalize relations, don't you try to assassinate the guy first? I mean, it just seems logical to me, right?
Multiple times.
Right. Yeah. Let's give him a poison ice cream cone. You know, let's make his beard fall out. Let's make his cigar blow up. I mean, it's like a fucking Groucho Marx movie or something. I mean, that's ridiculous too. I think there are two pieces to this. One is the Cuban Missile Crisis, which, you know, terrified the world, right? Because it was scary, right? And then in the aftermath of that, what Kennedy does is actually does tone down conflict with the Soviet Union. Although, again, look at the record. Wait a second, I have numbers here. In fact, numbers. You can't disagree with numbers, can you? Okay, here we go. Military budgets and military spending, which I think is kind of striking, right? So military budget is what's actually budgeted, spending is what you actually spend, right? As opposed to what you actually budget, it's the money you have allocated and what other people do with it. So the military budget, I'm just gonna do 62, 3, and 4. The military budget for 1962 was 54.6 billion, which was a 9.3% of the GDP that year. 1963 was about the same, 54 billion, which was 8.8% of the GDP that year. Then in 1964, it went down to 53 billion, which was 5%. But military spending in 1962 was 363 billion, in 1963 was 368 billion, and then in 1964 was 364 billion, right? And so, you know, when Kennedy was bragging in that trademark speech he was gonna give that night about how the United States had increased, and one of the reasons you see the defense budget, Eisenhower's policy was called massive retaliation, which essentially relied heavily on nuclear weapons and B-52s and aircraft carriers and things like that. which were far more expensive. Kennedy flipped to what was called a flexible response, which would involve kind of anti-guerrilla actions, the Green Berets, Special Forces, things like that, right?
And the Green Berets started in the Kennedy years, correct?
Yeah. No, that's my point, exactly. And so the reason you don't have the same military budgets is essentially Kennedy specifically did. Now, Kennedy always boasted about spending money on the military. He did it in his, remember, you know, his inaugural address, pay any price, bear any burden, you know, do whatever we have to, right? And so Kennedy isn't like gutting the Pentagon or anything like that. So first of all, that's important, I think, to stress. Secondly, people point out, like, Kennedy did institute the hotline between Washington and Moscow, which is great. Nothing wrong with that. And also they point out the nuclear test ban treaty, right? Now, the nuclear test ban treaty prohibited nuclear weapons tests underwater, in the atmosphere, or in outer space. Great, right? However, Kennedy had been an advocate of the nuclear test ban treaty since 1956. It was a basic liberal idea, right? There was nothing radical about this, nothing crazy about it. And in fact, when it was voted on in the Senate, I believe in September of 1963, August or September, the vote was 81-19, right? 81 senators voted for the nuclear test ban treaty. It was a basic liberal policy. There was no real opposition to it. I never saw any indications that the military was terribly, I mean, obviously they wanted to continue testing, but I mean, no one says this is the ground, this is why Kennedy was killed, right? No. So it's ridiculous. So so you have that, and that's the basis of it, that after the missiles of October, Kennedy was so alarmed that he decided to kind of, you know, break out the Cold War. Well, yeah, you have the nuclear test ban treaty, but you also have a continued massive defense budgets and continued modernization of U.S. forces and an even more renewed vigor to flexible response and special forces and the Green Berets and the SEALs and all that kind of stuff. Now, Latin America, I think, is important because Stone called the missile crisis, he called Kennedy's action the greatest single act of human courage the world ever witnessed with that much at stake. When I read that quote from Stone, I immediately thought of the Manchurian candidate. Raymond Shaw is the greatest, most brave, blah, blah, blah individual I've ever seen, right? And this is Stone. Stone is kind of a Manchurian candidate for JFK. He's really deeply in the tank. I've seen some psychobabble written about that, which I think is silly, but he's in the tank for JFK, no doubt about that, right? Stone also said that the problem was that after the missile crisis, Americans saw him as soft on communism. They thought he was weak, right? In fact, I went and looked at polling. 82% of Americans said that American power had increased. The Cuban Missile Crisis was seen as a victory for the United States. The only overture to Castro apparently was a pledge that the U.S. would not invade Cuba. Other than that, it continued to try to assassinate him. It continued to wrench him. Ask the Cubans about that embargo. Ask the Cubans if Kennedy lifted the embargo, how that worked out, right? I mean, come on, it's preposterous. So there's that. There's this evidence to the contrary. Kennedy, in his State of the Union address in 1963, which is after the missile crisis, said, "I can foresee no spectacular reversal in communist methods or goals," right? He said he's open to talks, but free peoples have no choice but to keep their arms nearby. There is no bargain basement way to achieve security. So that would mean spending $15 billion on nuclear weapon systems alone. And Kennedy says that sum is about equal to or the combined defense budgets of our European allies. The United States was going to increase spending on nukes by more than the Western Europeans were spending on their entire militaries, right? This is the dove, right? At the same time, what is Kennedy doing? He's helping engineer a coup in Iraq in 1963, the Ba'ath Party, of which a member was Saddam Hussein, overthrew the forces of Karim Qasim with U.S. assistance. Kennedy was deeply involved in that. It occurred in February of 1963. Karim Qasim was overthrown and assassinated. Kennedy wasn't so aghast at that assassination, was he, that he decided to change everything? Karim Qasim was killed just the same as Nguyen and the same as Nguyen Diem were, right? Kennedy didn't do anything about that, right? Kennedy, with regard to Latin America, had instituted a major internal security program, which I think is really important. This is where the United States, the U.S. has had various approaches, right? The good neighbor policy and modernization and development. And in the 60s, Kennedy created something called the Alliance for Progress. And the Alliance for Progress is part of that trend toward modernization and development in the late 50s. And the idea there is to bring this kind of rapid industrialization and modernization to these countries so that they can be, you know, they can have industry and they can have transportation and they can have tourism and they can have education systems and they can develop a middle class and engineers and professors and lawyers and things like that, right? It's like the Rostow, right? All that kind of stuff, which is the rage all over, right? Modernization in the third world means essentially the left, because that's what the left, that's what the third world wants. And you saw that with Mossadegh, you saw that with Arbenz, Nasser, Karim Kassim, right? And so Kennedy, while saying, you know, we're going to modernize these countries, actually ends up militarizing those areas, because the only way you're going to stop those forces that you want to stop, which is the left, is through internal security. Because the people in those countries, you know, are trending left very strongly, you know, and Kennedy is right to be concerned about that. What was the famous line about Trujillo, right? Ideally, we would like to see a democratic government elected there. But, you know, if not, then, you know, the alternative would be that we, you know, put some right wing government in. And we're going to have to do that. If we, you know, that's our choice. We're going to have to do that. It's like FDR, remember, with Somoza. Yeah, sure, he's a son of a bitch, but he's our son of a bitch. And Kennedy does the exact same thing. There's really no shift in that.
There's a story that I read yesterday about Argentina, where there was the president was a Frondizi, who was a constitutional Democrat. But his major flaw, I mean, he was having some issues with his economic policy, which was causing some unrest, causing the ruling class to be unhappy. But then he also was he did not denounce Castro. He did not. Mm-hmm. He was like totally open to Castro. And so when the right wing military had a coup against him, the Kennedy people actually didn't disagree, because he was too friendly with Cuba.
Yeah.
I think that's a big point, is anyone who came too close to Castro and violating their policy of containing Castro, they didn't really care about.
Yeah, every report you see, I mean, Castro's front and center. Lincoln Gordon, who's the ambassador to Brazil, you know, in all his testimony talks about the influence of the left in Brazil. And it's funny because he invokes Castro, but then he says, like, in the country, Brazil's like 75 million people and there's like 40,000 maybe Communist Party members. And he said, the problem would exist even if Castro were to disappear tomorrow, right? But it continues. And, you know, that's, I can't stress enough, the Alliance for Progress, the idea behind the Alliance for Progress was modernization and development. It quickly became a military program. And from this, you know, you get, you know, the School of the Assassins, and you get these internal security programs, and you get American training of the, you know, the civil guard, the Guardia, things like that. It becomes the most repressive program. It becomes a butchery, right? A bloodbath, right? You know, what's ironic is, like, you have a place like Guyana, and the leader in Guyana was Chetijagan, who was kind of a guy to the left. He had labor support. He was an advocate of the Alliance for Progress. He wanted in on it, right? And Jagan also, you know, I guess he didn't condemn Castro virulently enough. There was a right-wing oligarchy opposed to him. And so the CIA and the AFL-CIO began making overtures in 1963 in Guyana. And in 64, Jagan was overthrown, right? And so that was Kennedy's coup. In Brazil, same thing happened. There's a government there, a guy named João Goulart, who was, you know, a reformist who had, you know, labor and other groups supported him, and the CIA, and again, the American Federation of Labor. I mean, the AFL-CIO is really involved in all this stuff too, which is really an interesting story. There's some stuff out there, but you could do a lot more on it. But the AFL-CIO and the Department of State and the CIA are all on the same side in the Cold War. And so they go to Brazil and they overthrow Goulart. And this just repeats itself time and time again. And let me, again, you know, we talk about Kennedy at the end, right? This is John Kennedy's last speech on Latin America in November of 1963. Now, I don't know if he's had his epiphany yet. We'd have to ask Oliver Stone, like, if he has a precise date on which that occurred, right? If he knows exactly, like, was he, you know, taking sacramental, you know, holy water? Was he drinking scotch? Was he with, I don't know, was he looking at pictures of Marilyn Monroe? Was he listening to the Beatles, you know, on the Ed Sullivan Show? I don't know, it would have been the Beatles. But at any rate, Kennedy, in November 1963, Kennedy said the U.S. has a responsibility to come to the aid of any government requesting aid to prevent a takeover aligned to the policies of foreign communism. Kennedy said that, quote, every resource at our command will be deployed to prevent the establishment of another Cuba in this hemisphere. Wait, I thought Kennedy had gone soft on Cuba by this time, hadn't he?
He wanted to normalize relations, I thought.
Oh, really? Wait, let me read this again. To prevent the establishment of another Cuba in this hemisphere. Yeah, that's normalization, I guess, right? I don't know. Anyway, Kennedy was assassinated long after that, but the policies continued. And they never shifted. You know, go ask anybody in the Latin American left what they think of JFK. Just visit, go anywhere. I mean, in Kennedy's National Security Action Memorandum 134, which is kind of the basis for Latin American policy. It's the it's a report on internal security from January of 1962. It's a bit, I'll read it quickly, it's a bit long. But this is Kennedy. This is who he always was and who he was on the day he died. Countries having already critical problems in internal security accompanied by violence that requires urgent attention are Colombia and Bolivia. Political and class divisions are developing in Peru and Ecuador, which could soon place these countries in a similar category. If you're listening to this and you're not watching it, I'm laughing right now. Venezuela, Brazil, and Argentina are maintaining internal security through a delicate balancing of political forces, which involve the risk of sudden deterioration. In Chile, where internal security is supported by relatively good police forces, communist capabilities are being strengthened through constitutional processes and accelerated by a deteriorating economic situation. So, in three sentences, one paragraph, Kennedy has said that the United States has grave crises in Colombia, Bolivia, Peru, Ecuador, Venezuela, Brazil, Argentina, and Chile. Boom. That's Kennedy. That's the alliance. That's internal security. That's what this man of peace who was going to beat all of these swords into plowshares as he was on in his last days was doing. He was preparing to give this speech, you know, with bloody talons in Dallas, talking about nuclear buildup and, you know, money spent on defense budgets and stopping the Soviet Union. And he's preparing to ratchet up internal security and U.S. repression in Latin America. So, you know, I don't have it with me. I had $100 bill. I've challenged Oliver Stone. To sweeten the pot, I will pay him $100 because I know and I'll give it to him in cash so he doesn't have to declare. He doesn't have to file, right? Yeah. So come on, Stone, bring it on. Bring it on. If you want to send morally, that's okay, but I'd rather take you on. But I think they're afraid.
We take John Newman too.
Newman's still alive?
Yeah.
Oh, he is? Okay. Yeah. I want Stone, though. Come on. You're afraid, Stone.
If you can go on Joe Rogan, you can come on Green and Red.
Come on Green and Red, man. And but I'll give you $100 and you can just do whatever you want with it and no restrictions. A full C note, man, a Benjamin, all yours. Just bring it on. All right. But it's a ridiculous argument, which I would rather ignore, except way too many people and way too many people who are affiliated with political ideas that you and I believe in are taken in by it. And it's not as bad as QAnon, but it's not good. And it does follow in that same pattern of seeking heroes and myths instead of organizing and resisting. And I think that's not
well, where we it's also here. Important to note that the QAnon people actually make this part of their sort of narrative. You know,
they were in Dallas on November 22nd, waiting for JFK Jr. at least to come back to life. Right? No, it's a big part of it. Yeah, those are the two groups, Stone and QAnon. Yeah,
and they're two, you know, important leaders who have been struck down in one way or another, are JFK and Trump. And, you know, yep. To be perfectly honest, that some of the harm that comes from the sort of assassinology that all of these folks talk about is that it fuels that, right?
Yeah.
It's continuing to fuel right-wing conspiracies as much as left-wing conspiracies.
Yeah, I mean, it's as I forget who once told me years ago, it's not really conspiracy, it's policy. You know, it's what they do.
Yeah.
And you know, if you want to look for conspiracies, like Martin Luther King, it's Martin Luther King weekend. That one doesn't make sense. You know, an illiterate drifter ends up with a forged passport in London. Now, that's the kind of shit that you know, as part of a conspiracy, right? The military kills Kennedy because he's not adequately committed to Vietnam. Oh my God.
Right.
Oh, maron, as my people would say. You pazzo. You say pazzo. So anyway, it's crazy shit.
We're getting a bit to the end of our hour. Is there any final things you want to say on this today?
Bring it on, Stone. No, I mean, I think, you know, if you're listening to this, and we have a lot of new listeners, which we really appreciate, but if you're a long-time listener, a new one, I mean, you know, share this and tell people, you know, because this is really has a lot of currency. Oliver Stone's a very famous guy. He has access to all the media in the world. He can make movies and people give him a great deal of credibility. I mean, he made that series, you know, on, you know, the alternative history, which, you know, is actually quite badly flawed. But I mean, so he has this credibility as this person of the left. And you know, there are a lot of people out there who do really good stuff. And unfortunately, you know, they're not on the Majority Report and Jacobin and all these kinds of places. And so if you're listening to this, if you're watching it, you know, get the word out. Watch the Chomsky video again. But Noam does amazing work on this. I'm not Chomsky, but my stuff is, you know, I've been doing this for a long time and I know it well. And I am not in the tank for the military industrial complex. I have no love for the Pentagon, nor do I have any love for John F. Kennedy. But I mean, it's just, there's no evidence for it. And at the end of the day, you know, that's what we have to be as lefties. We have to like go where the proof takes us. And there's no reason to make up these, you know, conspiracy Camelot theories, because they do us no good at the end of the day. And it's been 58 years and we are still where we were then. And there's a lot of shady shit went down and the Warren Commission is goofy and there's all kinds of stuff regarding Lee Harvey Oswald that's really squirrely. But at the end of the day, there's no evidence that anybody in Washington, D.C., whether it be Dulles or the military industrial complex or some janitor or whoever, killed John Kennedy. There was no reason to. He was one of them. He was as much of them as anybody. He was in their world and he was of their world. And that's a good way to end it.
Yep. Folks, you've been listening to Dr. Robert Buzzanco at the University of Houston talking about JFK and Vietnam, JFK policies around the Cold War. We've been engaging with the Oliver Stone's new documentary, JFK Revisited, to give you a different story and to engage in some of the actual evidence and documents of the era. Bob is the author of Masters of War, Military Dissent and Politics in the Vietnam Era. If you haven't read it, you should check it out. It's a very important book if you're interested in subjects like this. And you've been listening to the Green and Red podcast. And if you want to follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, our Twitter's been a little bit hot with some of the Oliver Stone research team responding to us. So definitely check that out. If you're watching this on YouTube, please go down and hit that subscribe button. And if you really like what we're talking about, or you at least like, you know, civil discourse out there, think about giving us a donation. Go to greenandredpodcast.org and hit that support button. Or become a patron at patreon.com/greenredpodcast and become a recurring donor. Much appreciated, much love to everyone out there. Make trouble, misbehave, question authority, but also question the sort of, you know, these popular narratives that no one else is questioning.
And come on, Stone. I got my eyes on you. Come on, Stone. You and me, one-on-one. You set the rules all the way.
And if Oliver Stone or Jefferson Morley or any of these folks decide to actually take us up on that challenge, you'll see it here first on the Green and Red podcast.
I'll be here with a glass of scotch and my teeth sharpened. So right. Bring it on. Come on, guys. Don't be afraid. I'm just a professor. Okay.
We'll talk to y'all again real soon.
All right.
Everyone is voting for Jack, 'cause he's got what all the rest lack. Everyone wants to back Jack. Jack is on the right track, 'cause he's got high hopes. He's got high hopes.
opposition girl. Oops, there goes the opposition girl. Oops, there goes the opposition girl. Pop. K-E-double-N-E-D-Y. Jack's the nation's favorite guy.
Everyone wants to back Jack. Jack is on the right track.